things when we actually start the talk that I found out about today, when we were actually chatting backstage, is that he's a liberal arts major. And I asked him, it is a liberal arts major, how in the God's name are you able to chair a quality company? So, you know, he gave me one of the most wonderful answers. And, you know, you're going to have to take yourself, Rushad, what he told me there.
I feel very out of place in saying that audience like this. What I said was that, you know, I think it allows me to ask dumb questions. Oftentimes, you ask dumb questions about basic technology. You learn a lot, but you also get the other person to think very differently. That's one. And two is, you know, ultimately, technology matters in terms of the problems it can solve. And so, because you don't understand technology, but you understand problems, you become very use case focused. What are the situations in which technology can solve problems? But I definitely find it is a handicap that I can't code. It could have been advantage by code, but I can't. But I moved on beyond that.
You know, but I have a view to that. That just because you're not an engineer yourself, you don't fall in love with those problems and those products, and you take a more I would say a business or a commercial view to the product, and therefore you can bring a better success to it. Do you feel that in situations when you do projects, this has happened?
Yeah, you know, we're a services company and a product company, so we solve problems for customers. But I oftentimes find that in my conversation with customers, more and more customers are not asking about the technology. Customers are asking about how you're leveraging that technology to solve their problems. And so understanding pain points is becoming very interesting, right? And I find more and more those kind of conversations. So, a very interesting example I just learned a couple of weeks ago, where we're working for a customer in Ireland, they're in the mortgage space. Right? This is a customer that has 75% market share, so doing very, very well, but has really unhappy customers. Right? So, this whole project that we did for them was very much designed in helping a customer think through the journey that they put their customers through and what then needs to change technologically downstream once you understand what the problem is upstream. So, the conversation is moving much more upstream and technology is becoming an enabler to solve that problem once you understand what the human experience, the customer experience challenges.
So it's more objective, therefore.
Correct, and it's much more pain-point oriented.
Correct, yeah. Well, you know, so that's what happens when you actually put an liberal arts major in a technology startup. You bring more objectivity to the whole business. You want so many hats into the same organization that you're chairing today. You started on the floor as a business manager, and then you went on to manage government relations and investor relations, which is really huge and often painful, you know, because people will think you're a complaining soundboard, they can just come and complain to you. And then you've also been the chief strategy officer, where you sort of, you know, looking at newer services and newer areas for your organization. So, you know, having worn all those hats in the last 12 years, which role have you enjoyed personally? Which was personally very rewarding for you?
I think any job, if you don't get your hands dirty and the thick of things, in the muck of it, so to speak, you never learn, right? Because you're living in an ivory tower that's disconnected from what actually happens on the ground. But I have to say, very accidentally, the best job, the best learning job I think I had in many ways was when I was learning investor relations. And, you know, we're a public company, so we engage with a whole bunch of our financial investors, and I would meet about 150 of them every quarter. And there was one stakeholder who was not afraid to tell you exactly what he thought about you, about the company, about your peers, what you were good at, what you sucked at, and a very, very different stakeholder than employees or customers. So I found it very refreshing and very rewarding in terms of the learning that came out of that. And in many ways, that job was about articulating the growth strategy. Where was the company going, telling investors what you were doing, what you were prioritizing, etc., etc. And then after that, I moved to be the strategy officer at Wipro. And I remember having this conversation with my predecessor because he was moving to something else. And I said to him, I think this strategy job sounds very fluffy. It sounds like a paper shuffling job. You know, I don't have to give advice. And he gave me a big story which stuck with me. He said, it's like salted food. You can't see it, but if it isn't in the food, then the food doesn't taste so good. Right? So I realized that there's a value in that job in terms of what it can create and enable. So that job taught me about how do you prioritize? How do you prioritize the assets that a company has to make sure that they can get the best returns for those assets? In our business, are also some people, and money, but I would say predominantly people. So how are we getting that our best people are working on the best projects, the most important projects, the most critical things for the company? So it's a huge, huge learning. Both those jobs are very, very different things, but I enjoyed them both immensely.
That you're looking to achieve as a chairperson differently than what has been achieved so far?
I've certainly got more white hair in the last 6 months. It's a huge opportunity and a huge responsibility, and I feel incredibly humbled and incredibly blessed and incredibly happy. My father, Wipro, has built an amazing platform over the last 50 plus years, built a solid bedrock of integrity and the right values and the right sensibility, which I think really matter at the end of the day on what you can build off of. And so I'm very excited. You know, our opportunities are tremendous in the technology services landscape, and we can talk more about that. But I'm very, very hopeful for where the technology service industry can go from here. Right? The model in many ways in India began with cost. People came to India because of cost. They stayed because of quality. And then we all made money and grew because of scale. But this tremendous, tremendous opportunity emerging from new age technologies and the kind of services that you can offer to customers, because your relationship has shifted from being about cost and quality to really being a strategic enabler to the customers in their own journey. Every company now is becoming a technology-enabled company, right? And every strategy is technology-centric. So that's exciting.
If you choose top three sectors today to put
money
on, which three would it be?
I mean, I would put money in anything around cybersecurity, anything around IoT, and connected with the edge and data engineering that brings that information in a very structured or unstructured manner into the organization, and anything to do with AI. I think those are things that will have a huge play on the way business unfolds, at least in our business.
Going forward, I mean, say 10 years down the line, 15 years down the line, how do you think this philanthropic vision could be different? How will it evolve, or how will it change depending upon what is required in the country at that point of time? And where do you see yourself doing, or what areas do you yourself see involved as well as sort of funding philanthropic projects in the coming times?
That's a big question. So one, Ashok, we're very proud as a company that 67% of the economic interest of Wipro is owned by a foundation. That means that every 67 cents of a dollar we make goes to a good cause. And I think that's very powerful. It's very powerful for employees. It matters deeply as a people. It matters deeply to customers. So that's very powerful. You know, all our focus today in the foundation, which is an operating entity, is in the area of education. Right. And I'll share some of the challenges that happen. We work with the public schooling system in India, we work with government schools in rural India, in some of the toughest districts in the country. The magic of India is that there is a school within a 1 to 2 kilometer walking radius of every child in the country.
Well, that's
and this is not something that the British did, this is something that developed in the 60s.
Internally, yes.
Right? The challenge is those schools won't function optimally. And the challenge is quite profound, right? Because you can have a teacher teaching second standard, third standard, fourth standard at the same time. A teacher may be a multi-subject teacher, so she may be teaching math and English. Oftentimes a child may bring his sibling along, maybe there's nowhere to leave their sibling at home. And the best meal that that child may get is the midday meal the sibling serves. I've eaten those meals on many occasions. It's quite nourishing and good, right? So the challenge is very, very complex. So, as a technology company, initially, we try to put technology at the problem. And we learned very quickly that that's not the solution to the problem. How do you enhance the capability of the teacher to make her a more effective teacher significantly enhance the quality of the student? And the great example that I keep sharing is, how do you measure if you talk about a child's self-confidence? It's hugely important. Perhaps more important than being numerically fully literate or language fully literate, right? Self-confidence is important. Technology can't teach you that. A teacher can teach you that. Right? So how do we focus very significantly on enhancing the capacity of the teacher? That's our big, big focus.
I think that is first what needs to change, if technology has to play a big role eventually.
And technology can leverage into significantly enhancing the capacity of the teacher. We still believe at that level the engagement between the teacher and the child is very, very critical. We don't need brain trees in the context of what I laid out. The technology can address that problem.
Yes.
Perhaps it could over time. I don't know. So our focus very much is on leveraging technology, not so much but leveraging just the human interactions much more in our work in philanthropy. The other area that we focus on is on grant making. Right? So we support NGOs that are doing great work in what we call areas of vulnerability. So adolescent girls, women of domestic violence, small marginal farmers, people with disabilities, street children, railway children, runaway children, those kinds of things. We just need support. You can create impact. And if you're supporting 300 people today, you can support 600 people tomorrow, and you can have impact. And the challenge, the complexity of India, anything you touch, you can have.
Yeah, million complex.
Essentially, very focused to be
what you want to achieve. Yes, absolutely.